Hello everyone and welcome back to another Kerbal Space Program video, and in this Kerbal Space Program we're doing something very special. We're playing with mods. That's right, you probably figured it out from the title or thumbnail. I don't know what I'm going to call this video, but the mod in question is the central point of the video, so I'm sure it's included there somewhere. It is the recently updated to stock Kerbal Space Program Parallax mod by Gameslinks, and it is amazing. It's like a graphics mod that involves tessellation, and it's like a custom terrain shader that combines again the tessellation and displacement mapping to create very realistic planetary surfaces. Like it's game changing, put it that way. So of course we're starting in the vehicle assembly building where you can't see the effects of this mod, but you know, I've got to build suspense. I've got to get that viewer of retention up. And, you know, I wanted to showcase it. I saw the trailer for the mod. I had a look at it and I'm like, this mod is amazing. The world must know. So that's what we're going to be looking at in this video. And to kind of serve as a backdrop to me showcasing the mod, I thought I'd do a little mission to both the Minmus and Minmus and the Mun. Two different celestial objects, slightly different terrain, and just give you an idea of what this mod looks like, really, but it applies to every single planet and moon in stock Kerbal Space Program. I'm just giving you a little taster with the Mun and Minmus. And Minmus, I think, was my favorite out of the two. It looks absolutely spectacular from a low Minmus orbit, and indeed from Minmus surface, so I do hope you look forward to that. That's why I'm going with this craft here. So it's kind of like an Apollo setup, where we have a command module and a lander, but rather than the lander being two-stage like the Apollo lander was, it's only single-stage so that we can actually use it for both landing on the Mun and landing on Minmus. And as you can see, we've also got a rover on the lander as well, just so we can cover more ground, take a look at more expansive areas of terrain in this beautiful mod that you're about to witness. So that's that was my introduction to the video, said my part now, so now I can just sit here in silence for the next half hour. No, I can't make that joke, because it probably would unironically improve the video, wouldn't it? But regardless, let's just move swiftly along. You may be wondering, what am I building here? And it's an SLS-ish. It's like not quite accurate to the SLS, but it looks similar to the SLS, specifically SLS Block 2. The reason I'm making an SLS rocket is because I posted on Twitter, hey, I'm going to make a mission where I go to the Mun and Minmus. What kind of vehicle should I use? And I made like a poll. I think I suggested Saturn V, SLS, Skylon, or Space Shuttle. And SLS was the winner. So I decided to, you know, have the launcher be an SLS lookalike. Again, I must stress it's not very accurate to the actual SLS, but then again, the SLS technically doesn't really exist yet, so I can just take whatever artistic liberties I want. And there it is on the launch pad, so we can throttle up that mammoth engine and then fire up the SRBs. Now, before anyone says, you know, a more accurate, like, yes, functionally, a more accurate recreation of the SLS would have involved using the 5-meter tanks from the Making History DLC and the gigantic Clydesdale solid rocket motors that are, like, meant to be replicas of the Space Shuttle SRBs, which of course are the ones that are being used in the SLS. But I wanted the rocket to be orange. And the Mammoth engine, which is powering this thing, is modeled after the SLS engine. So it's kind of like, do I go with accuracy in terms of power and mass and capability of lifting stuff to orbit, or do I go with the aesthetics? And since we don't need a very powerful rocket because we're only going to the Mun and Minmus, I went with the aesthetics option. So here it is, there it is, in flight. And I even added the little NASA logo on the sides of those fairings, though I did make a slight blunder whilst building this thing. I didn't enable clamshell fairing deployment. Like, you know, in Kerbal Space Program, by default, the fairings just explode into 10,000 pieces when you stage them, rather than just nicely splitting into two fairing halves, like a real fairing would do. And when you don't enable the clamshell deployment, which is just the two halves, if you have a flag attached to the fairing, the flag won't deploy when the fairing separates. The flag will just stay there floating. I don't know if I'm doing a very good job explaining this, but you'll see in a second when we deploy that fairing, the flags just mysteriously continue floating next to the vessel. They do disappear when we drop the lower stage, but regardless, It was just a bit annoying. And there we are. The fairings have deployed. We've dumped that main first stage as well. Now we're firing our skipper stage. And wow, I'm really overcooking this, aren't I? And that's because I couldn't be bothered to circularize in low Kerbin orbit. We've got things to do. I wanted to go and have a look at the MUN, see how nice it looked. So I just went, let's just keep firing. We're going to keep burning that engine. We're going to go straight to the MUN, but we're going to put ourselves on a collision course with the MUN so that when we drop that lower skipper stage, it'll just crash into the MUN's surface, not be left floating in space forever and ever. And here, I actually put two decouplers there to separate the two stages, but there you go. So the flags have sort of stayed with that lower stage, luckily. And now we can get our spacecraft oriented correctly because the nuclear engine is going to be powering this thing. And as you can see, it's currently sitting in between the command module and the lander, which is where we don't want it to be. So we can reconfigure this in a very similar fashion to how the Apollo missions reconfigured themselves once they were in space. So the command module would separate from the lander below it, flip around like this, and then extract the lander from the Saturn V upper stage. And that's what I'm doing here. And now we can just adjust our trajectory so that we're actually, you know, not going to meet a similar fate to our lower SLS stage. I don't think I went for a free return trajectory here, actually, which is not very Apollo-esque. Not that this is even attempting to be an Apollo recreation, so I'm not even sure why I'm getting so fixated on the inaccuracies of it, because clearly there are bigger things at stake here if we're going to nitpick this for not being a very accurate recreation of Apollo 11 or what have you. Anyway, now that mess of a sentence is out of the way, we have our MUN encounter all planned out nicely, so we can just plan a maneuver node to get ourselves circularized to the MUN, and then there's nothing left to do other than time warp over to our MUN encounter, and there it is. And as you can see, as we get closer and closer, you'll see those beautiful shaders come into view. Look at that, guys. Isn't it breathtaking? And it looks way worse from orbit than it does on the ground, at least in my humble opinion. So I'm looking forward to seeing what you guys think of how the MUN looks from the surface. But how's this for a little teaser right here? The ground passing below us as we perform our capture burn around the MUN. And that is all done now. We can get ready to transfer two of our Kerbals into the lander cam. In this instance, I'm going to use Jebediah Kerman and Bob Kerman as our two brave Kerbonauts that'll go down to the surface of the MUN, because it'd be good to have a pilot. By having a pilot, it means we could create maneuver nodes from the lander can without necessarily having a connection to the Kerbal Space Center. Obviously, Jebediah can do that. And we've got Bob Kerman as well, just so he can restore the science experiments on board the lander can. We have the Mystery Goo unit, and we also have the Science Junior, both of which can only be used once if not restored by a scientist Kerbal. So that's why I selected Jebediah and Bob in this instance. And there they go. I think I was just time warping for like trying to reach the daylight side of the planet, but I think just my map screen was looking very dark for some reason, because when I closed the map screen, it still looks pretty bright. I like doing stuff in Kerbal Space Program on the sunny side of planets and moons whenever possible, because YouTube's compression algorithm makes videos look very dark. So doing everything in as bright a setting as possible is always preferable. And here comes the surface, rapidly accelerating towards us. I did time the suicide burn fairly close, but it was fine. We didn't crash. And as you can see, once we get really, really close, you'll see that tessellation, I mean. And for those that don't know, if I'm just saying the word tessellation, it means like the undulation, which is actually not a very common word either. Like the bumpiness, that's the ground looks bumpy, that's tessellation. And the mod doesn't just make things bumpy, right? Like it's got custom lighting and texture blending and lots of other stuff that I don't really understand because I'm not a programmer. To be honest, guys, I just sort of skimmed the forum post and was like, I think I have a vague understanding of what this is. And what this is here in front of you as we deploy the little ladder and open up the side doors on that command pod. I'm sorry, by the way, I know clipping parts in Kerbal Space Program is somewhat frowned upon, and I have very much clipped that Science Junior piece into the side of this lander can, but I am at my wit's end when it comes to trying to design landers that look good, but also landers that include the Science Junior. It is such an awkward part. It's a terrible diameter. Really, it'd be nice to have a Science Senior part that's like what is it, 2.5 meters in diameter, the same diameter as the Landercan there. And it's so tall as well. So if you have a Mark 1 sized lander, like a huge proportion of that lander's height is going to be the Science Juniors. You end up with a very tall lander that falls over easily. And then if you have a lander like this, where it's got a nice wide stance, it's 2.5 meters, which is the same width as the best lander can in the game, don't at me. But then where do you put the Science Junior on a 2.5 meter diameter stack? So I'm like, you know what? I don't care. I'm just going to clip it into the side of this command pod and we'll just call it done. I mean, if you actually look at the IVA view inside that command pod, there is a laboratory inside. So technically, the Science Junior is only being clipped into the internal laboratory on the lander. So really, it's all fine. And that's kind of how I've justified it, really. You may have noticed I deployed the little rover, by the way. And you may have noticed, although I didn't pay ship... you might... I don't know if it showcased it particularly well. But that rover didn't, like... How do I word this now? It didn't respond to the bumpiness of the terrain. It just cruised through all the bumps and divots on the ground. And that's because tessellation is a purely visual thing. It doesn't have any impact on the physics. So when Kerbals walk over the bumps and lumps and rocks that come with this mod, they'll just go through them. It's a purely visual shader. It doesn't have any effect on the actual physics. Which means that actually, you can run this mod surprisingly well on most PCs, which is something I can talk about in a second, but right now I want you to bring your attention to the assembly of our Surface Lab just here. Oh, I love the little click sound that antenna makes, but I want you to look at this. I placed the seismometer, or whatever it's called, the seismic activity experiment. It's definitely not called that, but you know what I mean, this one. And I noticed the little pad actually clipped underneath the mystery goo experiment, so I thought, let's just quickly pick it up and move it. But then, oh, well, it's gone. Where'd it go? It's not inside Jebediah or Bob's inventory. It's not back on the ship. It just disappeared. And so if that's not worthy of a spooky like, I don't know what is. I don't know what that was, but yes, if you are formally now, if you are enjoying this video, then leaving a like is always very much appreciated. Thank you very much. And if you are enjoying this video very much, then you can subscribe. I make Kerbal Space Program videos every Saturday, and every Monday I make a little space news series in which we cover kind of topical events happening in spaceflight around the world. Got all that plugged in as we get ready to talk about this next thing. So we've got the rover here. I played it fairly fast-forwarded motion, as you can see. That was kind of a good example of how the tessellation doesn't have any bearing on the physics of craft. And I wanted to scan this little crater here. So this crater that I'm trying to maneuver myself into a scanning position for is not part of the parallax mod. It's part of the Breaking Ground DLC, as is this little robot arm that I'm scanning it with. I thought it might be nice, you know, if we've built a rover to showcase how terrain varies, it might be worth just making it functional as well and can actually perform some experiments. So brought the little scanning arm with me, and we can use it again on Minmus, but we won't get too ahead of ourselves. Now we can get back to the lander and I guess, yeah, get ready to depart to our next destination. Now some of you might be wondering how this thing gets back onto the, like, we are going to be taking the rover with us, so some of you might be wondering how it gets back onto the lander. And I could explain to you as we approach the junior docking port that's on the top of the rover, and indeed underneath the lander can, has quite a strong magnet. So all we need to do is maneuver the rover underneath the lander can, and the magnet that's on board the junior docking ports will just pull the two craft together, and the rover will just bounce up really nicely. Now, if you want to use this craft on a celestial body with higher gravity than the Mun, this might not work. I haven't tested this rover on any body other than Minmus, Mun, and Kerbin. Kerbin is obviously the planet I built it on. And I noticed that while the magnet thing works on the Mun and Minmus by extension, it didn't work on Kerbin. But there is another way. What you can do is you just move the rover underneath the lander can and then switch to the lander can, and you right-click the landing legs and just reduce the spring strength. I think you have to spring strength and damper strength by default is just set to automatic. So you change it to override by manual, and then you get some sliders. You just reduce the strength of the springs, and the lander will just sink under its own weight, and in the process will lower its docking port onto the rover. So if you want to take this lander somewhere like Eve, I don't know why, because you're not going to be able to go anywhere once you've landed. That's how you would redock the little car to the lander. And that was it. That was the mum. So I do hope you enjoyed. I'm trying to think if there was anything I needed to talk about specifically regarding the Mun that I didn't talk about whilst I was there. But I think I did a pretty good job in covering it. I mean, there wasn't much to talk about. I'm sort of letting this mod do all the talking. Like, I'm not really talking too much about the mod specifically because look at it. It's great. I mean, I do have Scatterer installed. And Parallax was developed alongside Scatterer, so the two are compatible, and actually GamesLinks does recommend having them both installed together for the optimal results. So if you want to make this game look extra, extra good, then make sure you've got Scatterer installed as well. And Scatterer, anyway, is like one of the best mods you could do. You could install anyway. Like, it makes the ugly, ugly, ugly water of Kerbal Space Program look so much nicer. So yes, highly recommend Scatterer as another must-have mod if you want your game to look pretty, at least. And that's it. I mean, some of you might be wondering at this point today, like, Matt, what kind of PC do you have? The game is running so well. What kind of nuclear-powered computer do you own? And I will interject there. You don't actually need a very powerful PC to run this. I mentioned this very briefly when I was on the surface of the Mun, that you don't actually need particularly powerful CPU, a particularly powerful CPU to run this thing. It's fairly light on the CPU. It shouldn't affect the actual core performance of the game too badly. What it will obviously have a bearing on is the graphics card in your computer. But even then, you know, the forum's minimum settings just say that you could expect to run Parallax fairly well on a GT 960M or better. The recommended specs, I think, was like a 970, which is still, you know, by 2020 standards, is a fairly, you know, cheap card. I mean, a 1050 Ti will crush that card, and you can get those for pennies these days. So I think it's a safe assumption that if you have a gaming PC, you'll be able to run this mod fairly well. And even like a semi-decent laptop could probably run it okay. And with that good news out of the way, here we are executing the lounge lazy method of docking. I did mess it up the first time because I accidentally enabled RCS on the lander, and then I pressed the wrong button and the ships got thrown out of alignment. But basically what I was doing was when you're in the lander, set the docking port of the command ship as your target, and then press auto SAS target next to the nav ball, and then you switch to the command ship, do the same thing again for the docking port on the lander, make sure it's set to auto locked target, and the ships will just maintain alignment really nicely. They just drift together and it's really easy. You don't need RCS. It's great. I do have RCS on these ships, and I like having RCS on many ships just because it makes things like very fine adjustments to orbits much easier. Like if you're trying to do an encounter with, like, say you're doing a rendezvous like I just did, and your closest approach to the target is like 0.3 kilometers, you can just like turn on RCS quickly and just use HNJKL and I, the translate controls, to do very fine adjustments to force those nodes together without having to do loads of rotations on the nav ball to point your engine in the right direction. So that's why I often like having RCS jets on not RCS jets. You know, you guys know what I mean there, right? The RCS ports on ships, even when I don't necessarily need to do rendezvous. And even when I do, I very rarely use RCS to do it. And there we are. We are on route to Minmus. What I did do, actually, I don't know if you noticed, but I did time warp to a point where I could get a Minmus encounter directly from the Mun, pretty much. Obviously, I needed to do a mid-course correction to get the inclination right. But other than that, we got our encounter fairly easily. What you do to make sure you get that, at least my armchair knowledge, I've never actually looked up if this is the most efficient way of doing it. What I've always done was you zoom out on the map screen so you can see the entire Kerbin system. By Kerbin system, I mean just Mun, Kerbin, and Minmus, not the entire solar system. Imagine a clock face. You want it to be at 3 o'clock, and so you want the Mun to be where the 3 would be, Minmus to be where the 12 would be, and Kerbin is the middle of the clock. That's like the point at which you can go directly from the Mun to Minmus. And that was my horrific tutorial on a thing that most people don't ever need to do in Kerbal Space Program, as we have finished our circularization around Minmus. And wow, doesn't it just look breathtaking? feel like that's really sarcastic. Just that. Oh, another good reason to have RCS, by the way. You can just quickly move the ships apart. It's not going to hit each other once we do our retrograde burn with the lander. But yes, oh my goodness, doesn't Minmus look so pretty? So I decided to aim for somewhere other than the Minmus Flats because I land at the Minmus Flats quite frequently, and I think it'd be nice to have a change. I mean, didn't I do a Minmus mission last week and we landed on the flat? So let's aim for somewhere a bit more rocky. Not only will this add some variation to my channel, but also you know, there is more potential for rough terrain. I don't actually know what the parallax shader looks like at the Minmus Flats, but maybe that's a little investigation for you guys. A little activity for the reader at home. You can download this mod, install it, do a little trip to Minmus, maybe using this craft, which is available to download in the video description. And you can let me know, or tweet it at me or something, I don't know. And here we are touching down. Now, all of these boulders are part of the mod. So all of these boulders, I think they're part of the mod anyway. I don't remember Minmus being this rocky, although maybe it changed and now I look really foolish. Either way, they're not physics objects. That was probably a better phrase than that. But they're not affected by physics. You can just morph through them. But for realism's sake, whilst we're... landed a little hop as the two vessels separated. For realism's sake, when we're driving around with the rover, we'll make sure we avoid them just so it looks, you know, as it would expect. Help maintain the illusion, so to speak. And the same, I guess, went for, you know, how the fact that the tessellation on the ground doesn't have any impact on objects that are moving across the ground. And so with that, we can get the Kerbals onto the rover and we can have a little explore. Where's Jebediah? Where's that Bob? Oh, it's Bob, actually. I've got a very small preview window in Sony Vegas. So I sometimes have to squint a bit to see the name of the Kerbal I'm controlling. And they are on board the rover, so now we can go and find ourselves another breaking ground surface feature. So I'm going to play the footage back super fast here whilst I went searching for one. And I spied that little obelisk shaped, that big rock termite hill looking thing in the distance. So I zoomed towards it. And then I realized that brakes don't work particularly well on this car. And we subsequently smashed into the side of it. Luckily, no harm was done. The rover is still in one piece, so everything worked out okay in the end. And there it is, so we can do a quick scan with our scanning arm and see what data we can acquire from it. So first things first, we're going to just quickly try and orient ourselves into a better position for the scanning arm. And in fact, I think the first thing I did was, we're just running all the little experiments first. We've got to get those squared out of the way. And whilst I'm doing that, you can see I'm just sort of parking this thing in a place where the scanning arm can work. And, forgot to remove the data from our MUN expedition, so I quickly removed it. And then we got back on and get ready to run the scanning arm. I love the animation that the scanning arms do. It's so cute, isn't it? Oh, there it goes. Only the little scanning arm, so we're not going to get too much science from this. But at the end of the day, this is my Laon Aerospace save where we've got the holotech tree unlocked, so it's not really an issue that we didn't get that much science. We did get a somewhat passive-aggressive note telling us to come back with a better scanning arm to get more science, but whatever. Look, Bob is happy. He can jump like Superman. And then we can do our very important planting of the Laon Aerospace flag. Very creative name, just Parallax Minmus as our historic landing site, although we have done a lot of Minmus landings on this so far, so I guess it's become fairly routine for the Kerbals at this point. We've got barely any science from all of our other experiments aside from the scanning arm, so clearly we've been here too many times in Laon Aerospace. Now, where did we park? I was like zoomed out, and I was like, where's the lander so we can head back? And can you spot it? I couldn't see it. I had to go into the map screen in the end and just set the lander as our target so I could find it. There it is. Where is it? I mean, if we set it as our target, I don't think you can actually see it. We can just see it through, like, via that reticle through the rocks. So if you are an idiot like me, then you could just go onto the map screen, set your lander as your target, and just look for that little yellow box. And if for whatever reason the yellow box doesn't show up, because this happened to me, and it took me ages to figure it out, you press F4, and F4 will toggle the box, like the target box, on and off. So if I were to press F4 at this moment, obviously nothing would happen because I'm commentating over footage. But as I was recording the footage, if I pressed F4, that little reticle would disappear. And I press F4 again, it would come back. So there you go. That happened to me. It was a couple of years ago. And I was really confused at the time. I had to ask on Twitter what the answer was. And that's the answer. Answer to a question that probably no one asked. Here we are gracefully, the Kerbals gracefully disembarked the vehicle and landed on their feet, which is pretty epic. The brakes on this thing don't work particularly well. But I guess it doesn't matter because we're back now. So we do need to quickly take the data from the rover. And I guess we can like manually flip it up so it can just remain here on the surface. So should we ever visit on another occasion without a rover and we land near this spot, the Kerbals can just moosey on over to the parked rover and use it again. That was the theory anyway, but that theory did fall flat on its face in a bit, as you'll see, as events shall transpire. But I won't spoil exactly what happened. But just prior to departure, I decided to restore the mystery goo unit so that if we ever did revisit this spot in the future, the Kerbals could not only reuse the rover, but can also reuse all of the science experiments on board. In case we come down, we don't have a scientist Kerbal who can reset the mystery goo containment unit and make it usable again. So there's the rover, and I folded in the wheels, just, I don't know, because it felt like the right thing to do, I guess. But don't know. If anyone was wondering if I was doing that for a specific reason, there wasn't. I just sometimes just do things. I'm like a dog chasing cars. And the dog would be more successful if the cars had their wheels folded in and were motion. Okay, this is not funny. Let's move on. I mean, yeah, what do you guys think of this? This is going to be the last time we see a celestial body other than Kerbin this close up. So this is kind of like one of the last times we'll get to see that beautiful tessellation effect. I mean, my goodness, maybe will squads consider integrating this? They probably won't because they haven't integrated Scatterer, and I don't know why. I mean, at the very least, they could just make clouds. Like, they don't have to incorporate a mod that has clouds because there's so many. They could just do it themselves. And I know that the devs like the clouds because I've seen them occasionally post screenshots of their games. And they've got the cloud mods installed. So anyway, here, did you see that little explosion? I was like, what is this explosion? And so I pressed F3 to look at the action log. And it turns out that the rover, it just died. I guess it was just really sad to see us go. The rover just spontaneously exploded. So not quite sure what happened or why it happened, but that was the end of the rover. That was the big reveal, right? I like hyped it up a bit by saying, oh, the rover's going to get destroyed. And everyone's like, oh, is Matt going to crash it? And no, the Kraken. Kraken was hungry, I guess. Anyway, yes, stock clouds, squad, please. That would be pretty epic if you did that. I mean, but speaking of KSP updates, have you guys been following the KSP 1.11? Is that the latest one? I can't remember what the number of it is now. The latest KSP update, for those of you watching when this video comes out or near the upload date of the 14th of November, I think. It's the 12th for me because I'm recording. But yes, 14th of November is the date I anticipate this video to go up. So guys, if you look at the latest KSP update news, it looks pretty good. We're getting more RCS ports, and crucially, they're finally fixing that really annoying thing with the RCS blocks, where they've only got 4 vents, which I guess is the realistic, I guess if we're going by like Saturn V standards. But the 4 vent configuration that the current RCS blocks have is only really good if you have a spacecraft like this, where it's just a round cylinder, as opposed to a square cylinder. Now I say that loud. But it's just a round cylindrical craft, and you can just radially attach 4 RCS blocks to all sides symmetrically. But if you've got an asymmetrical craft, or you've got something like an SSTO space plane, it's really, really difficult to place the RCS blocks to a point where they look nice. Because a space plane with an RCS block on the top and bottom just looks a bit naff, really. And of course, realistically speaking, you don't really want an RCS block on the underside of the space plane, so that when it does the re-entry belly flop, the RCS block is getting maximum exposure to re-entry heating. But this was a very long-winded way of saying that they have now added a vent to the top of the RCS block. So we have 5 vents on the RCS blocks, not 4. So you could just mount a couple of RCS blocks on the sides of a fuselage of an SSTO space plane, not have to worry about placing some on the top and bottom as well. And it's great. I'm really excited. The other thing I'm really excited for is they're finally fixing that really annoying side effect of the game's physics, where you landed a vessel without landing legs or wheels on the surface of any ground that isn't completely flat, and you've just noticed that it will just gradually slide about. Same thing with Kerbals. Kerbals will just slide about if they're not on a perfectly flat surface. Well, apparently they've added this thing called vessel anchoring now, where ships will sort of anchor themselves in place and won't slide about on the surface, which is, oh, thank you so much, Squad. I mean, this is the thing I'm actually most excited for, not the RCS thing. And they're also adding some more lights as well, which is always nice. So I'm excited for this update when it drops, Squad. I'm hyped. Thank you very much. I did actually tweet about the sliding thing getting fixed. And I think Kerbal Space Program liked my tweet, as in, you know, the official account. So I'm glad that they like my liking of that, I guess. I don't know what I'm trying to say. Hey, look, the ground is tessellated again. So Bob could quickly jump out and take off his helmet instantaneously when he hits the ground. There we are. Tessellated ground. Isn't that nice? And I guess we can, like, fade across. Actually, before we do fade across to an end screen, we can have a look at how much science we got. 431.9 science earned. I'd say that's a pretty good mission. And here we're going to end with a little shot from earlier, shortly after I redocked with the command module after our moon expedition. But yes, here is a final little goodbye for this episode. Don't worry, it will be installed in future episodes of the Parallax mod. Hope you guys enjoyed it. There is a link in the description to the mod. I probably should have mentioned that right at the beginning of the video. Oops. There's also things on screen to other things. But I've kind of like screwed myself over because I just went on like a waffling tangent and now I've run out of time to talk about anything.